morning. Good morning. Welcome to St. Luke Lutheran Church. Whether you're a first-time guest here or you've been here many years, we're so happy to see you. Welcome to all those joining online for this Baptism of Our Lord Sunday. We'll get started with that in just a minute. I wanted to let you know we're going to try something a little new here for the next couple of weeks at least, where it's called the Ecumenical Prayer Cycle. We will add into our prayers this morning a special petition for a few countries. This morning will be Iraq and Syria. The Ecumenical Prayer Cycle comes from the World Council of Churches, and over the course of the year, it allows you to pray for every country on earth and all the people and churches in those places. So we'll try that out this morning, see how it works for us. But this morning it'll be Iran, Iraq, and Syria. With that, we'll begin with our prelude. Friends, rejoice in this good news. In Christ Jesus, your sins are forgiven. You are descendants of the Most High, adopted into the household of Christ, and inheritors of eternal life. Live as freed and forgiven children of God.
Amen.
Thank you.
grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you. Sons from far away and my daughters from the end of the earth. Everyone
reading from Acts. Now when the apostles at Jerusalem heard that Samaria had accepted the word of God, they sent Peter and John to them. The two went down and prayed for them, that they might receive the Holy Spirit. For as yet the Spirit had not come upon any of them. They had only been baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. Then Peter and John laid their hands on them, and they received the Holy Spirit. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Grace and peace to you, friends, and the one who can live and breathe and have our being, Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Shortly before I left for college, I received a letter in the mail from the school. I opened it and discovered that I had been assigned to live in a dorm called Brantford, and that I would in fact be living there all 4 years. My college took the same strategy as a number of other schools do that, which is to divide up the student body into different subgroups, to take a community and create a community within it. The idea being that you would live among the same people, the same friends, for all 4 years. My friends and I, so we lived in the same community, yeah, so that for all 4 years we would primarily eat from the same dining hall, we join the same athletic intramural teams and compete against the other areas of the college. The Brantford Squirrels were unmatched. My school called each of these dorm communities residential colleges, and there was 12 of them in total. Even before arriving on campus, we were invited to strongly identify with wherever we would be, to make it kind of part of our own college identity. We each had our own chance, our own quirky traditions, and each had its own sense of place within the wider university community. And so it was interesting when formal approval was given during my time there to add two new residential colleges to the mix. Construction began on them after I had already left, but they were going to add two of them, two to make 14 rather than the original 12. Beyond the big sense of change that this would have over the college and the expanding student body, what made this interesting was how the dorms were to be populated during those initial years. Incoming freshmen could simply be assigned there, but that would not be enough people to populate them. And so upperclassmen were invited to leave their previous dorms, previous home communities, and to join these new additions. For for those that chose to do so, leaving their friends and communities behind was probably a big decision. For some, it probably was unthinkable. But the ones who took up the offer did it for a number of different reasons, I imagine. One, maybe just the prospect of new facilities. For others, maybe they didn't feel at home in their previous dorm. They didn't maybe feel at home in the one they had been assigned previously. They didn't have the friendships they hoped for or the sense of belonging that they sought. And then finally, there was those who, I think, at least I heard from kind of stories from friends, who did it almost out of a sense of altruism. They were seniors, thankful for the sense of community that they had in the beginning when they were starting college, and they wanted to contribute to creating a new community, to help the freshmen coming in feel that they belonged as much as everyone else. For all these reasons, one previous way of identity was exchanged for another among these students that were joining. A new identity took priority over an old understanding. In our gospel this morning, we encounter Jesus at the moment of his baptism. This is kind of a bit of a jarring jump in time for those who have been with us since Christmas. Even last week, Jesus was still essentially a baby in a manger, and all of a sudden, now we have him in his adulthood standing before us. And yet, Matthew, Mark, and Luke all do this. They all make this jump from Jesus at his time of his birth in the manger to his adulthood in baptism. It's in these moments that this happens. It's right before Jesus' entrance into public ministry. Why would they do this? I think they do this in part because it's a question of who Jesus is. All this story is the question of what is Jesus' identity. In a stunning display where the heavens open up and the Holy Spirit descends like a dove, we hear a voice declare to Jesus, "You are my son, the beloved. With you, I'm well pleased." Before Jesus begins his public ministry, he is given a foundation on which to stand. It will strengthen him the rest of his ministry. It strengthens him in his love to us, even as he goes to death on the cross later on. But what does Jesus' baptism have to do with our baptism? What does it have to do with ourselves? Well, we live in a world where there is no shortage of ways of defining ourselves. There's no shortage of possible identities. No shortage of labels that we can use to describe ourselves to others that help clarify our own sense of self and individuality. Most of these different identities are good. They are unique. They help us see and know ourselves as unique members of the body of Christ. Our identities like how old we are, what our ethnic or cultural background is, our religious affiliation, sexual and gender identities, and even our economic status. There are also various identities we might have within a family, whether we are a mother or a son or an uncle or wife or a sister or stepdad or a whole bunch of combinations of these. But we also live in a society where many of these identities become fractured, or where one group is set at odds against another, especially in a world as politically charged as we are right now. There are labels and identities others suggest to us. One can barely turn on the opinion news shows these days without claims being made about who we are and who others are. Claims about which team we belong to. Claims about the other side being evil or sinister. At heart, all of these things we hear about us, about others, are about our identities, claims about who we are and who others are. And so today, on this day where we look at Jesus' baptism, I'm grateful that the first glimpse we get of Jesus' adult life is in this moment. In this moment, we see God give the final word to Jesus, and in our baptisms, to us about who and whose we are. Baptism bestows on us a new and final identity, an identity of ultimate concern, as the theologian Paul Tillich would say. A baptism baptismal identity that is our foundation. It can be confusing. Baptism is a sacrament that's been debated and tossed around over centuries about what are the specific meanings, what are all the different ways of going about it. Various denominations understand it even today in very different ways. But I think one of the gifts of Lutheranism is our absolute insistence that baptism is not something we do for ourselves. As Lutherans, we're adamant that baptism is an act of grace that we don't choose for ourselves. It's an act of divine salvation, a personal declaration from God to us that is given as a gift. We don't choose this identity, and we certainly don't do anything to earn it, but rather it's bestowed upon us, it's imprinted on us. Baptism is something God does to us, something God says about us, and in saying this thing, God makes it true. God claims us and says, I love you. In our passage today from this morning in Isaiah, we get the only time actually in the Bible that we get those three words together. I love you. God's baptism of us tells us who we are in relation to God. We are beloved. And it's also a promise from God about what this means for us going forward. God says, because I love you, when you pass through the waters, I will be with you. When you walk through the fire, you will not be burned. Because of this, we don't choose baptism, but we do respond to it. In our baptismal liturgy, we say at any baptism, we make promises to God in return, or if we're an infant, our parents make those promises on our behalf. The first set of these promises is about our life of discipleship. We live as we grow in faith. We promise to live among God's faithful people, to approach God and God's word and the Holy Supper, to learn the Lord's Prayer, the Ten Commandments, and the Creed, to hold in our hands the Holy Scripture, and to be nurtured in faith and in prayer. Those are the set of the first promises we make. They're all about discipleship and our role in that. And the reason we make those promises is because they help us grow in trust. They help us then turn outward in trust of God to our neighbors. And this continues the final three set of promises we make in baptism. In our liturgy, then we promise to proclaim Christ through word and deed, to care for others in the world God made, and work for justice and peace for all. All these promises we make flow out of the fundamental beginning statement, the truth that God loves you. Can't live well together if we're building walls between ourselves. Like the college upperclassmen, we're given a new home in baptism. If you're like those students seeking a new home because you didn't feel at home where you were before, you need a new identity, we have it here. If you're like those students who are seeking new ways of building bridges to create a community and a loving vision of the way that God wants the world to be, our baptismal identity provides us a way. The next time you feel pulled by the world or the news in so many different directions, when you hear claims that you belong to this team or that team, when the ground itself begins to feel shaky about who you are, remember that God has already made the final claim on you. God says, I love you, I have called you by name, you are mine. In this watery immersion, in this claim of divine love, we have the best and truest statement we could ever make. Ourselves. You are God's and you are loved. And in this baptismal truth, you have been sealed. It's our foundation forever. Thanks be to God.
is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken to your prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
The Spirit of the Lord is poured out upon us in abundance, and so we are bold to pray for the Church, the world, and all God's people.
Us from fear, Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
Afghanistan. His family came out early. He was a translator and had to come home early, had to come back to the United, had to come, not home, had to come to the United States early. And he has been working to bring family members and help others come over. And we as a church have been very grateful for all that the church has done for him. And he is going to speak Thursday, 10:30 on Zoom. I sent the Zoom out to the women's group. If you didn't get it, please let me know, and I will send it to you if you're interested in joining us. It should be very interesting what he has to say. And he would love to, I think, see as many people as he can so he can thank you for what you've done for him. And that being said, Thrivent, we got $2,700 worth of grants from Thrivent between October and December of 2021. Let's go for $10,000 this year. Just say it. Thank you.
Good morning. Wanted to give a reminder that next week after the service will be our annual congregational meeting. We'll have a quick break in between worship and the meeting with a few snacks. The meeting should be relatively efficient and brief, but please do attend. It's a great summary of what happened in 2021, and a look forward into 2022. And on that note, if you have an annual report for the meeting, it was due this week, so hopefully you already turned it in. But if you didn't, please go home and get that done right away. Thank you.
I want to thank Millie for encouraging Debbie write a grant for this year's pageant with the Thriving Grants. And Lucy's making good use of what was left over to buy next year some smaller costumes. So Thriving Grant is a year-round endeavor, right? We thrive with our thriving. Two, I'd like to thank Joe for stepping up to be cantor this morning. With the spike in Omicron, maybe in a week or two, we can see it fall down, but until then, in an abundance of caution, we'll be curtailing singing, and even the band is just having tomorrow night a turn in for music and plan for next year meeting, so we're not blowing or singing for the next week or two. So choir, stand by, but everybody be safe.
Thanks, Rich. I encourage you to check your bulletins for any other announcements, and with that, we will continue with our offertory.
Oh,
You are indeed holy, almighty, and merciful God. You are most holy, and great is the majesty of your glory. You so loved the world that you gave your only Son, so that everyone who believes in him may not perish but have eternal life. We give you thanks for his coming into the world to fulfill for us your holy will and to accomplish all things for our salvation. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to the disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." For as often as we eat of this bread and drink of this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.
Christ is God. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
Remembering, therefore, his salutary command, his life-giving passion and death, his glorious resurrection and ascension, and the promise of his coming again, we give thanks to you, O Lord God Almighty, not as we ought, but as we are able. We ask you mercifully to accept our praise and thanksgiving, as with your word and Holy Spirit to bless us, your servants, that these, your own gifts of bread and wine, may come and fill and share in the body and blood of Christ, may be filled with heavenly blessing and grace, and receiving the forgiveness of sin, may be formed to live as your holy people, and be given our inheritance with all your saints. To you, O God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, be all honor and glory in your holy church, now and forever.
Amen.
Gathered in one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught us.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Bless you and keep you. The Lord may shine on you with grace and mercy. The Lord look upon you with love and give you peace.
Amen.
Thank you.
good news.
Thanks be to God.